When do you guys want to stop streaming? I could keep going because I'm addicted to Stardew and hanging out with my buddies, but I understand if y'all are getting tired or hungry.
I'm cool. I just need to use the restroom.
Okay. Whatever. I mean, you can do that whenever.
You could, should just run another ad. We could use the restroom and see how I feel.
Okay, we'll do that.
Okay,
jeez.
I have to pee real bad.
Just like, force me, why don't you? Okay, fine.
Also, I'm helping.
Be right back, everybody.
Oh, someone is impersonating another user.
Oh, okay.
This cat.
Is it Eros again? That's sad. Has he said anything good yet? Like, I mean, bad. There's two, the admirals.
Oh, I see.
Okay, I think it's the person saying that they're retarded and stuff. Really cool. Hey, the real admiral, say something that, I like.
Only the real admiral would know.
Only the real admiral would know. I found him. That reminds me that the word, retarded should also be on the word blacklist. I hope I didn't ban the wrong one. Okay, I got the right one. Cool. It was difficult. I really, like, that's such a baby script kid thing to do. Like, I'm going to use the same, I'm going to trick people by using a capital I instead of a lowercase l. It's so cool. I'm the best. All right. Living off the land. Oh, sweet, it's salmonberry season. They're gonna be everywhere.
Salmonberry.
Oh, spirits are neutral today. Salmonberry does not sound very yummy.
No.
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 Sounds gross.
They're weird looking though in real life. I'm just googling them now.
Oh. Well, how weird do they look?
They're berries, but they like, I don't know. Hold on.
They're berries, but they're off. I don't like them.
It's mostly just that like there's some good pictures of them still with like sort of the flower bit on top.
Potato rain.
Hopefully this is not too big. Let's find out. There you go.
Oh, they are weird. Oh, they look pokey. Like, you don't want to put them in your mouth. They look poisonous. They look like they're saying, don't eat me. I'll kill you. Don't fuck with me. I'm a salmonberry. Scrot berry. if your scrot looks like that, see a doctor.
Yes, please. Consult a medical professional.
That's not how it's supposed to be. I don't think. I need one more clay and I can make the fucking thing I want to make. Holy crap. What else should I do today? Well, I guess I can plant some of these spring seeds. Why not? Oops, I need to water them too.
Have you ever played the Fable games?
I feel no.
Like no, right?
No.
In Fable, you'll be able to age literally in real time. You'll be playing this game forever in eternity, and then you'll die. And in heaven, I'll have made Fable 2.
It'll be the last game you'll ever need to play, because it will
have
last
forever.
Have you seen
the Peter Molyneux Twitter?
Yes.
The guy making fun of it. Yeah, it's so good.
He's great.
I loved the original Fable, but I also heard none of the hype. Like, I literally just happened upon the game, picked it up knowing nothing, and thought it was super cute. And I've been, like, hankering to play it again.
I liked it a lot when I played it the first time. I think it didn't live up to any of the hype.
Well, let's see. I lucked out, because I think not knowing the things that Peter Molyneux promised probably helped me enjoy it much more.
I mean, living a life without hype is probably the best way to go about things.
I thought it was a fun, I mean, if kind of simple game. Like, it's kind of a bare bones RPG, but that's fine. That's not a bad thing.
You can get a secret pet. Explain.
Go on.
Excuse me. Continue.
Either way, the cute music in this reminds me of like how much I love the sort of cutesy little things in Fable.
Speaking of hype, tell me about this pet and how it will change my life.
The problem with Fable is I can never play an RPG again because I've played The Witcher 3 now and nothing else matters, so...
True. True.
Oh, I have heard about that secret pet, actually. I have not found an ancient egg yet, though.
An ancient egg!
Ancient egg.
Some part of me, like, slightly wants to do a Let's Play of The Witcher games, but I don't want to suffer through the first game and the clicking mechanism.
I considered it, and I went back and tried to play the first one for about 5 minutes, and I was like, no, this can never be done. No one should do this.
Because it feels like for completionist's sake, you should start there, but...
Yeah, I was like, you know, you couldn't just do a Let's Play of Witcher 3 because, like, you'd have to explain much.
First and foremost, though, I love Witcher 2. Like, that's what made me fall in love with it. I played Witcher 1 all the way through because I thought it was neat, but I put it on super easy and just, like, waltzed through because I was like, nah, no. Mm-hmm. Like, the story's cool, but this is but otherwise.
So, I have played only part of Witcher 2.
What?
Picked 3 on, like, a whim, I think. I mean, I think I heard it was good, so I picked it up. And, like, loved it kind of instantly. I have since, I've read, like, half of the books at this point. Yeah, it's good. It's good. It's a good game.
You should play 2 all the way through. I thought it was pretty good as well.
Witcher 3 was my favorite game of last year, for sure.
2, I always describe it as such, but I got 2 and I was like, this is exactly what I wanted from Skyrim, is like a really finely knit narrative where you feel like you have stuff you could do that's off the beaten path, but like the main thing is nice and like tight together. Obviously that's not what you get in the Elder Scrolls games.
Yeah, the problem with first of all, I think what I liked so much about Witcher 3 is that it had someone writing it that like knew how to write words good.
Good description.
How like, novel it, for it, that to be in a video game.
It's so disappointing when people like when you play Skyrim and you're like, well, I'm gonna not even touch this story. I'm gonna skip all this dialogue because it's all so fantasy genericisms like thrown around in no interesting ways whatsoever. And we must stop the time-eating dragon from beyond zone. In the north, where the fires burn in the wind.
Pretty accurate.
Really, annoying, and also there's so much like not meaningful content in Skyrim. Like, go into X cave and find X berry.
Witcher 2, that first bit, when you're in, is that Flotsam?
Flotsam?
I sat in that little dwarf shop and read all the in-game books, which I've never done in my life with any other video game. And that's how I knew. I was like, yeah, I'm into this. I'm really into this. Do I now know where Redania is? Absolutely, I do.
So I did that with Witcher 3. I read a lot of their texts in it, actually, because I was like, this is probably maybe worth my time, finally. it's good, and I like the books. I would recommend them. Genuinely, I think they are a good read. They do a lot of stuff that Witcher 3 did, and I was surprised to see in a fantasy book. And the first collection is just, like, all fairy tales, so that's kind of neat.
They're cute. I really enjoyed... Because I played 1 and then 2, and then I read the books, so it's like exactly when he gets his memory back. So it felt very rewarding when in 3 he's like running into people and he's like, I remember you, and it's like, I actually do. I just read that. Hooray.
There. Now I don't have to wait.
Yeah, also Witcher 3 just did a really good job of making a game that felt like a live to me, like that was like a world where stuff was happening in it, because Skyrim does not have that feeling. Skyrim just feels like a map and there's stuff on it, which is fine, I guess, if you're looking for time, to, like if you spend time someplace. But like Witcher 3, I felt like, oh, I am in a place where there's stuff happening and people.
Well, like when you're outside of the main town, right? And you walk up and there's like the washerwoman dyeing clothes and there's different colors of dyes and stuff.
Yeah. That's
I just find really that so good. Impressive. There's a whole like in-universe economy happening.
And the environments like tell you so much about the game. Like when you first show up, like for the Bloody Baron quest,
That was an interesting quest. I watched Chip play it.
Like, and you see all of the hanged men in the trees, and like, it just looks very it's like it looks perpetually autumn, and it looks like a very kind of depressed way.
Right. Well, it's like it's equal parts depressive at times to like picturesque.
I love walking around in it because it looks great.
It can be pretty and then like incredibly depressing in another turn. You're like, oh, okay.
and then it's like, in contrast, you get to Novigrad and it's like, I was very impressed that they have like so few big cities in the game, because like in Skyrim, obviously there are so many large cities. And yet Novigrad feels like so dense and has as much content as the first part of the game does.
Right.
It being in like a very small area. And I thought it's just such a good game. Like, it's just so well made. And then you get to Skellige, and it's also good.
Aside from the dumb little here, all these hidden treasures floating around in the water.
Oh yeah.
All those damn exclamation points and question marks.
I did not do a lot of those, to be honest. But
there's no reason to.
I just did the game, like the side quests that had like story elements to them. Yeah. But that's what I also like, was that the side quests had like actual narratives to them, as opposed to there's a guy in the cave, please go get him, please fetch the sword from cave.
Right, you're actually a monster hunter and people will pay you to do the thing that you say you do, which is
it's
monsters.
Like so many little quests had like so many narrative touches. Like there's one quest where in Skellige where you go dive for a pearl for some guy who wants it for his wife.
Right, back in Novigrad.
Yeah, and you find out at the end that the pearl is that she has like cognitive disabilities and doesn't remember anything. And he hoped that the pearl would be in some way beneficial to that. And I was like, you know what? That's a thing that most games wouldn't tell you or bother to include. Or the guy in the DLC who takes photos with his dumb camera. and you find out that his daughter is bedridden, and so he takes these photos for his daughter. Mm-hmm. And then he also talks about how, like, if you go, you can look at the exhibit of his photos, and one of them has his face, like, burned into it, like it's an accident. And he's like, yeah, it looks really bad. I include a bad one in every exhibit because people keep telling me it's really good.
Yeah, there's a lot of good depth.
I mean, everyone talks about Bloody Baron, and it's like, that's obviously...
Well, because it's a good quest in and of itself, but also the side quests, there's a couple side quests that tie into it in a way you wouldn't imagine it would.
Yeah.
Yes.
That was kind of interesting when I was watching that happen. I was like, wow, this is still the same quest? It's like, so long, but not like, drawn out?
Yeah.
Sort of?
I like that and people talk about this, obviously, but like, I like the way they present Bloody Baron to you. Like that this is obviously, this is a complicated thing, and they don't shy away from it being complicated. Like this is a bad, like this person has done some very bad things, and in many ways it's probably a bad person. But you're given, it doesn't like cast a judgment on him in its writing. It's very much left to you to judge, you know, for yourself what this is about.
And I think a lot of games try to do that and fail, like Deus Ex being like, you know, what do you think about racism, y'all?
Yeah. we're gonna present apartheid in a
yeah,
in an
like,
objective way.
Yeah, it's like.
That's a game where like the side quests and whatnot feel much more thought out than the actual like things that happen when you talk to random NPCs on the street or yeah. the main quest, frankly. Yeah.
From what I saw, that seems to be the case as well.
Also, yeah, the Witcher DLC, I like both of them for different reasons. Like Blood and Wine feels more like the main game in that it has like a very fleshed out world. And also it's really fun and very charming, very immediately. And I like Heart of Stone for being a smaller narrative. I think it functions well, and I think that Geralt fighting the actual devil is goofy but fun.
Oh, Mr. Mirror. That's fantastic.
Yeah. I liked that they added, like, that. First of all, that they added a callback to him in Blood and Wine. And his little song in the world popping up is nice.
Mm-hmm.
Man, why is there never any trash in the trash cans?
I do not like Fallout. I'll just be honest that I don't really like Fallout. New Vegas, I guess, being the exception, but I didn't really play it. I mean, it sounds like it's better than the two most recent ones.
4 is pretty meh overall, I think.
I personally. Don't like 4. I really don't like it.
I played the third one and liked it, but then I never finished it because I heard that when you finished it, that was like it.
Well, it just
you couldn't like, go back. And then like a year later, I went and I decided, what's the end of that game? And I just walked to the end and I was like, okay.
It just reminds me of Bethesda's other Elder Scrolls games where it's kind of a lot of the world is just full of stuff, but it's not a value stuff.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Well, I think that's why New Vegas is, if you're ever going to like go back and revisit, that's the one to do because it's Obsidian rather than straight Bethesda.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that you could see the difference in the writing style. And then also, like, we were talking about how in Witcher 3 you have, you know, sort of a you walk through a town and you can see like, oh, they make bricks here and blah, blah, blah. In 3, when you walk around, you have no idea how those people feed themselves.
Right, right.
In New Vegas, there's like little farmsteads and like very specific trading routes. It just feels like they really put a lot of thought into how this post-apocalyptic world would function. So.
Well, yeah, I've heard that it's good. I've heard that there are many positive things about New Vegas, which is good. The other thing is that, like, in terms of like in-game environments, I didn't like Fallout 3 because it's so brown. Like, I have a kind of lack of interest in the post-apocalypse as an environment to begin with because there tends to be very little in it. Like there's
it tends to be a wasteland.
When you call your environment the wasteland, it's like, okay, well, I'm not expecting there to be a lot to see here. And it's the same kind of thing with Fallout 4, where there's a lot of areas of just like, this is gray, okay?
Yeah.
And like, it's the polar opposite with something like The Witcher, where the environment is so fun to look at, where like, I stop riding around just to look at things in it.
Right.
Because occasionally you'll catch a really great moment where like there's wind trees and it looks great. And even like where like Blood and Wine, where I thought I'm not gonna like this as much because it's perpetually summer here and I'm not interested in that as much. And then you walk in and it looks fantastic.
Which is stylistically very different because the whole point of that whole area is supposed to be very like actual fantasy.
Yeah, yes, very much
like Disney fantasy.
And when I began to learn that, I felt I got more out of it. Because it feels more like it feels more like The Last Witch, where it's actually fantasy. Also, the ending of Blood and Wine was great, and it made me very happy. It's a rare thing where I feel good about this character retiring. Like, mm-hmm. I really want that to happen.
Right? You feel for Geralt.
I feel a lot of things. Yeah, exactly. And when Yennefer spoilers, when Yennefer shows up, I'm like, that's cool. I'm happy about this.
Depends on how you play the game, my man.
Depends on how you play the game, obviously. Yes, because you can end up in different places. But...
Oh, sweet. It's raining. Nice.
But I obviously have. I judge you if you.
Oh, obviously.
If you ended up with Triss, I have judgments about that.
No, that is incorrect, and you played the game wrong.
Because also, like, I mean, I guess if you start with Witcher 1, maybe you have a different opinion, but, like, if you read the books, like, they have a very negative opinion of Triss in general.
Even in 3, she goes ahead and tells you, like, oh, I was deceiving you. Like, yeah, all right, great, thank you.
Like, in the books, she comes off as, like, very childish.
Mm-hmm.
And just kind of... Yeah, bratty, I think is the word. They never make her seem like outright awful because she has done a lot of things and they establish her as a fairly important person in the world, but like very
You know what it is? It's like it's just partially that first game is a weird amalgamation of several bits from the books.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
In like a strange retelling instead of a new content way.
Yes. Mm. Yes.
So she takes on more characteristics from some of the other characters rather than her own from the book straight ahead. That's the same thing, like you re-see the intro cinematic is the
retelling
story,
from
the book. And then you go ahead and they sort of retell it again in the game.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I need to grow some
parsnips. I did know that. I did see that.
Mm-hmm. What a good series.
Are salmon berries anywhere in here? I have a feeling they're not. Nope. 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 Don't gotta deal with those. Never mind.
You can just eat those weird suckers.
Mm-hmm. I don't need to. I feel fresh. Feeling fine. Is anybody's birthday coming up? Pam! It's Pam's birthday! Oh my god. Too early.
Yeah, the collectible lady cards from the first game were also super questionable.
Yep.
Oh, gosh.
Which they did away with, thankfully.
Mm-hmm.
They did. That
and
was good.
Onwards. It's a game like that is so good on its own that I've replayed it like several times, which I don't normally do.
Which game?
2. I haven't replayed 3 yet because it's long.
I've started playing 3 and then I took a break. But I will resume it, but I took a break.
The only mod I have applied to 2 was just to make his hair more actually white. Instead of, because it's like silvery.
Mm.
That's wrong.
It's kind of weird.
Not to canon.
Looks weird.
It in the second game it does. He also just generally looks a little weird.
He does look a little weird in 2.
Oh man, now I'm thinking
I love
about
Geralt
that,
when he has that like hipstery haircut where it's shaved on the sides.
That's
what I keep him in always. Obviously,
I was like, "That's a damn fine boy."
You start out in like a sort of a
unkempt guess,
recall sort of thing at one point where you like you remember being back in the Kaer Morhen base, and he's got that haircut. I think.
Yeah,
and I was like, ooh. Where do I get that? Give me that. That's what I want.
He's a handsome boy.
First things first, how do I get myself onto a horse? Second thing, where do I go for a haircut?
Oh, it's a cutscene. Have we seen this cutscene?
No, I've not, I don't think.
What's your favorite Geralt moment? It's the pun battle that he does with Yennefer.
That is pretty good.
In Skellige.
I love that whole quest. It's beautiful.
That's really good, yeah, in general.
Ahem. Coupons for 50% off at Jojo Mart. No!
What an asshole.
I know. Nobody can resist that deal.
evil 50%. Bastard.
What an ass.
Can't match those prices.
You shit.
Look at that face he's making.
Gonna punch your dumb face.
Oh my gosh.
Pun off screen. Also, they're tied by fate. Come on. So good.
Yeah, it's honestly like. So since I did not play with your two before starting the game, like when you start with your three and you start like in the dream sequence with Yennefer, like at this point it was basically deal sealed here. Like, also like you spend the first part of the game looking for her, you know, like.
Right. Yeah. There's mm-hmm. There's a drive there.
Also, she's more interesting than Triss. Also, let's just be honest. She is more interesting as a character, but.
Also, I think their story is sweet. Like it was something mm-hmm. to do with like. There's a genie.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
And they were in love, but then like the genie made them forget, and then they fell in love again or something. Well, something.
I do like the story where Geralt meets Yennefer, like, because it's like just him being like really dumb the whole time, because he's like she's really hot though. like he's instantly in love with her. And it's a fairly enjoyable story.
That's my favorite thing about reading
you
the books is
dork.
Like, you're supposed to come across as pretty brooding, but then in your head he's like, oh, he's just kind of a teenager. I know he's like 100 some odd years old. But
oh
like,
my god, yeah, that salty letter she sends to him in Blood of Elves is so good. Because he signs the one he sends to her as like your friend.
Yeah.
Oh, and she's so salty about it.
Gotta move my scarecrow. I don't think he's in the proper place no more. Got too many crops. He's gotta protect him.
And the Jackdaw one is like after they've already done the genie, yeah?
Yes, that's after the last wish, yeah. And then also that really, like, their one in Sword of Destiny that's just it's just a story about their relationship, that's it. Like, he does fight a trash monster at one point in the very beginning, but then the rest of it is just, like, him finding out that she's been, like, seeing another guy.
Yeah, yeah.
And, like, them dealing with that and her dealing with that. And I thought it was a fairly, like, honest thing.
Oh my god, I'm sick of smallmouth bass. Give me something.
I'm telling you, you're gonna have to start, you know, marketing fish pants.
Fish pants.
Also, I thought that I liked the fact that Witcher 3 feels a thing that I liked was that it feels like Geralt's the side character in his own game.
Because it's way more about
Ciri than it is about him.
Yeah.
Because I like that Ciri did all the like big world saving stuff and you didn't even get to see it. Which I don't care about anyway, so that's great. Whereas Geralt's just doing kind of small scale stuff in the background.
Mm-hmm. While looking for her, and every person he meets is just like, I've met this badass lady. She did all this crazy shit.
Also, there's the part where Ciri comes back to Kaer Morhen, and I felt like that felt very much like a chapter in her book, because like everyone else, she's like knows that no one's changed and everything, and it felt like these are very side character.
Geralt's on some dad adventures,
yes he is. He's a good dad.
He's a lovable guy. I liked him from what I saw of him.
I did not actually play
the game myself. Oh, right, the goat. That was funny.
I also really like the Peller. For whatever reason, I really love that character.
The Peller's pretty great, yeah.
Also because
he has a Halloween quest.
I just generally like the... Like, when the game decided to have a sense of humor, it was a pretty good sense of humor. Like, it's not like it's a goofy game or anything, but like when there are humorous quests, it's like, this is pretty, that's actually kind of funny.
I liked Velen kind of immediately because it was, because there are witches in it. And I really liked the crone's designs.
They were really cool.
They looked great.
They were super cool looking.
And they were perfectly disgusting. And I also like that you can later go to Bald Mountain. Like, I thought that was really cool.
Oh my god, it's been so long since I've played the beginning of the game, but I know there's some joke when he sits down with, it might be when he's sitting down with the guy to learn Gwent for the first time that girl makes that made me laugh really, really hard. Oh shoot. It's so good. If you're talking about like a favorite moment, that's a really good one.
I also like that they set up, I mean, it's sort of goofy that they set up their DLC in that in the tutorial, but it's great though.
That's very forward thinking to be like, hey, this random throwaway guy. Not so throwaway, not so random.
You may remember.
Oh,
yeah.
That's interesting.
It's just one guy you talk to, and he's very weird, but like, and so sort of memorable in that way, but yeah, he comes back in a big way for the DLC.
Wow, I didn't know that.
Hours and hours and hours later.
As IRL Satan. Yeah, I also like that DLC as like a devil story in general, because I like how classic it feels. Like, I like meeting him at the crossroads and stuff. That was cool. That was a sort of endearing fairy tale kind of moment.
Good game of them.
I don't think I fished in this lake yet, really.
Well, here's some ding-dang seaweed.
Mm-hmm. Enjoy. Why is there seaweed in a lake? Oh no, that was algae.
Oh, okay. Well.
I was like, what the? Oh my god, please. I bought this new rod
just
for a reason.
Thing. Please, something. Anything, please. Give me anything.
I'm desperate. Desperate for fish.
I'm begging it. I'm begging you, man. I'm begging you.
Yay! A new fish.
That episode's gonna need Witcher 3 spoilers in the description.
Yeah, it probably
oh,
will.
Oh, yeah.
It probably will. Also, I really like Gwent, and I'm really excited for that Gwent standalone game.
Dude, I am too. That is another thing. Like, in 2, they have a different kind of game that I, like, played for 2 seconds and went,
I like
know.
The background of the board you roll the dice on.
Sure, but you know how many times I rolled the dice off the fucking board?
Mm-hmm.
So many times. So many goddamn times. I decided it was not for me.
But Gwent is a lot of fun, and I'm excited for the standalone. Also, I like the idea of Geralt just being so into this game. Every time you go to like an innkeeper, like, what are you hankering for? I'm hankering for some cards.
Friggin' Gwent, man.
I need you to play some cards.
Do you have any of this universe's version of Magic the Gathering cards on you? Because I would.
I buy those immediately.
I have killed so many monsters with which the fruits can buy me more cards. I just, please, please, please.
Apparently, so Lodite notes that the standalone game is maybe not fun to play with people unless. That's okay, because I expect that. I mean, I have. And hope that most people I'd be playing against did.
I'd imagine, yeah.
But also, it does have, like, a standalone, like, single player content.
This fish wants to die.
Yeah, right? He doesn't care at all.
I didn't have to move the thing at
Kill
all.
Kill me!
I'm a carp, I want to die. Me.
Understanding. Yeah, every innkeeper just nods. Yes, yes.
Of course, of course.
Gwent.
We got the stuff.
I can hit you up there, bud. I got your Gwent fix.
Does standalone have the Skellige?
It does. It does.
Huh.
But I don't know if the standalone has Nilfgaard at this moment.
I
it
love
maybe
Nilfgaard.
Might not.
God damn it.
Currently, they don't have a deck, but maybe it's just because it's closed beta, or maybe it's like a forthcoming thing.
Oh, Nilfgaard's the best because it's just like, how many spies can I put on the board without murdering myself? How many cards can I get in my hand but also give them power?
Well, that's the same with Northern Realms for me, where it's just like, I just spies out the wazoo.
Oh, Northern Realms, I play strictly, like, how many siege weapons can I get on here, and how many clear cards can I put in here to make sure that nobody rains them out?
I like monsters, but it's really hard to play.
Oh, beautiful.
I don't understand how to build a deck.
I have a theory on how you build it, and it's worked occasionally. where it's just packet full of everything.
Pretty like everything else, you don't want to do that because obviously,
you're limiting,
especially like with any doubles where they up in power when you play them together.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, with monsters, though, you kind of have to put as many as you can because you don't want any duplicates in your hand.
Right, you want them. You want to be able to play one and have it come out.
This is
game.
Our Gwent strategy stream.
I'm just sitting here.
I'm really
fishing.
Not good at Skellige. I'm really not good at Skellige.
Me neither.
I don't really know how to play them.
I don't think I have enough. I mean, like, I know I have all the cards. So says the game, but it doesn't feel like I do.
Yeah, I just don't know what the strategy is. Yeah, I don't dwell on the canicity of Gwent card names.
That's true. No one should know. He should be like a mysterious figure.
Yeah.
His name
also,
should not
why
be
would there be a Siri card? Everyone thinks that Siri's dead. Like,
true. Can't go too deep into that.
Yeah. Or yeah, like, oh man, why would there be like all the spy cards make zero sense?
That's true.
Whoop! That's my strategy. Fishing all day. Oh, there's some bubbles over there. Shit. Gotta get on I'm that. Just, like,
I apologize for all the Witcher talk. I'm just happy to find someone who's equally impassioned about that.
I'm very passionate about. I have a lot of thoughts on it.
That is okay. It gives me time off to zone out a little, actually. Oops.
It's a weird video game, I guess, but it is very close to card game. Because
yes,
it does give
it
you,
is,
like, here's a whole bunch of options, and maybe you will have some garbage options. Figure that out for yourself and put your deck together accordingly.
It's one of those things where, again, it feels like a very lived-in kind of thing because it does feel like an actual card game you're playing. And
I
don't
know how long they, like, had to figure out how to make a card game.
I wonder how many
people are in charge of that or if they, like, outsourced that to some game master somewhere else. Like, make us a card
game
for our world.
Origins of Gwent.
Who invented Gwent?
The dwarves.
Well,
it'd be funny if his name was like. It'd be funny if his name was like Glenn Went. He named it after himself.
That's what I believe in my head now.
Glenda. Glenda Went.
Glenn. You could say Glenda. Glenn or Glenda. Who knows? Glengarry Glenn Went.
What are the ABCs of Gwent? Quickly.
What are the ABCs of Gwent? Come on. Like it's got to be always B, but then what would the C be?
Yeah, I don't know.
Really, because in my mind, the way you play Gwent is spies. Like that's how you play Gwent.
Shoot, I feel like there's a good answer for this.
Always be carding.
I always be counting, but what would you count? Well, I'm
counting how many cards they have in their hand.
Yeah, I mean, I do that a lot.
I do that a lot.
That is kind of my. I mean, honestly, my Witcher strategy or my Gwent State Northern Realm spies until they have no cards left, and then like that's it. That's I just outcard them. And which is why monsters is the most fun to play against because they'll always drop from hand. So it's like I can absolutely devastate them with like two spies. Although it's unless you're playing like Nilfgaard, in which case they probably have a million decoys.
Sorry, so they can pick up all the spies you throw at them.
It's really annoying.
Largemouth bass, a kerp. No bullhead, no sturgeon. I think those are in different seasons, perhaps. Sigh.
So yeah, I'm interested to see how the standalone game actually plays.
Well,
they've changed spies. Damien Monnier. Is that really the guy that made Gwent?
Yeah.
Because that sounds like it was your name.
I'm really sad his name isn't Glenn Wendt.
Glenn Wendt.
So he kind of drew influence from Hearthstone and Netrunner.
Yeah.
Netrunner is a thing I can't wrap my mind around, by the way, if you've ever played it.
I have not.
No,
it's a two-player card game where, like, you know, you sort of have different decks. It's sort of already pre-made for you, and you kind of can rearrange them slightly. And then, yeah, one of you is, like, trying to hack into a big corporate infrastructure, and the other one is the corporate infrastructure.
That seems weird.
I don't... Dave really likes it, and I'd hate it. He took the time to learn it, and then we tried to play it several times, and I just couldn't.
Oh, man. That sucks.
Yeah.
Also, we should probably like call it a stream. It's been 3 hours. I'm starting to get hungry.
Yeah, I am.
Hungry for Gwent.
Hungry for Gwent. Dude, I would play some Gwent right now.
I tried to get in that alpha.
I did too. Well, I hope I can get in a closed beta. I want to be. It bothers me that you don't draw two cards for spies anymore. I'm just gonna get that out there. It really bothers me. It just greatly upsets me that you have to pick.
Anyway.
Just get it out there. I'm sorry. I've just got to say it. It's on record now. Everybody knows it.
Thanks for watching the Stardew Witcher Gwent stream. thanks.
That's the danger you have with both of us on your stream. I guess.
Now I know that, and I will prevent it in the future. You'll never see each other again.
Why not?
I'm kidding. I don't care. Yeah, thanks for watching. I'm gonna run another commercial at the end because 3 commercials, 3 hours. Makes sense, right? I'm waving at the screen for some reason. I don't know why I'm doing that.
Bye.
I guess I'm tired. Bye.
Bye-bye.